Hello friends, welcome to Smart News Digital. Today, let's see the current affairs of 24th August 2018. The news articles we'll be seeing today are the 6, and let's see them all in detail now. The first article is about accepting help, UAE's aid to Kerala. This news article was there in yesterday's paper also, and it was repeated in today's editorial. Let's see some more points regarding the same issue. The government of India has declined the United Arab Emirates' offer of 700 crores to aid Kerala's disaster. In light of that, the Ministry of External Affairs spokesperson said this decision of the government was in line with the existing policy and the central government would meet the requirements of Kerala through other domestic efforts itself. Apart from UAE, other countries like Pakistan and Maldives have also come forward to help Kerala's affected parts. The Ministry of External Affairs has also told that only persons of Indian origin, non-resident Indians or other international foundations are eligible to send money from overseas to Prime Minister or Chief Minister's Relief Fund in order to help the disaster affected states. But however, there exists a confusion between what is actually told in the document and what is actually done. This issue is also reiterated by Chief Minister of Kerala, Mr. Vijayan, as he told about the lack of clarity in the existing policy of National Disaster Management Plan. The policy which was put forward in the year 2016, it states that India will not appeal to any foreign aid, but it will take care of its needs with domestic funds in case of any disaster. However, the plan also has a clause that if any national government of any other country gives assistance to the disaster victims as a part of goodwill gesture, that is, it comes forward and gives the aid voluntarily, then the central government can or may accept the offer. This clause is also mentioned in the same plan. So this mismatch between two clauses of the same plan has created confusion now. It is also to be noted that India was struck by tsunami in the year 2004 and the government of that day also declined foreign offers claiming to the same clause of the same document. Currently, the calamity faced by state of Kerala has been declared as a calamity of national level importance by the central government. And a democracy like India must respond to such grave emergencies and calamities in such a way that it benefits the greater good of common people living in its soil. Though the foreign aid must be scrutinized carefully, one must not decline the foreign aid just because it is from another country and it may be a breach to the internal security of India. Though India is definitely a self-reliant country, India must definitely give up its strange pride and join hands with other countries to help Kerala, especially in a highly connected multilateral world of 21st century. The second article we are going to see today is Center wants Supreme Court to get through with FB and YouTube. India and all around the world is experiencing digital revolutions for past 1 year and it is definitely going to increase in the coming years. So the government is finding ways in order to curb the circulation of online videos, especially dealing with sexual violence against women and children, which is a grave threat to its citizens. So the government is likely to seek Supreme Court to frame greater strict guidelines and directions to service providers such as Facebook and YouTube in order to seek and stop such crimes. Currently, under the provisions of Information Technology Act, any intermediary like Facebook or YouTube, they take almost 36 hours in order to block a video as per the government directions. However, if these guidelines are framed and changed, this time taken will considerably be reduced to 10 hours, which is very much important to protect the dignity of the affected people. The government is also seeking to implement other proactive monitoring tools in order to prevent such incidences occurrence in the future. And it is also important that the intermediaries like WhatsApp, Facebook or YouTube, they share the data of the identity of origin of such content. Only if identity of origin of the content is provided, then the person who has released it can be caught and put to justice. That is also very important. While there are other guidelines to deal with such incidences now, only Facebook has complied with them partially and WhatsApp and Twitter are yet to comply with the guidelines. In the light of the importance given to the right to privacy as part of Article 21 of Fundamental Rights, these guidelines are definitely important to give importance to the privacy of individuals as well as different institutions. The third issue we are going to see today is with respect to extreme rainfall, a challenge to reservoir operations. This is in the light of the current heavy rains experienced in the state of Kerala. And apart from Kerala, the other reservoirs in different parts of our country are also at risk, according to this article. This is because of the increasing climate change that India has been experiencing and will experience in the future. The catchment areas of seven large reservoirs that produce hydropower are likely to experience substantial warming in the years to come. This substantial warming is due to the climate change in the country, and because of the climate change, the temperature will rise, and this will raise the water level in the reservoirs. It is predicted that the mean average rainfall that the country experiences will drastically increase in the future, and by the mid and the end of 2070 to 2099, the century will experience drastic changes due to the global warming. This assessment particularly has analyzed seven water reservoirs in our country. These seven reservoirs are the large reservoirs existing in our country. They are Nathpa Jakri, Bakra Nangal, Sri Sailam, Nagarjun Sagar, Hirakud, Sardar Sarovar and Indira Sagar. Out of these seven reservoirs, two important reservoirs are located on the river Satluj, that is Bakra Nangal and Jakri are located in Satluj River, and Satluj is located in the Himalayan region, and the snow melting due to increasing global warming increases the water in the reservoir, which is a grave threat to the dams. The five other reservoirs are located in monsoon dominated climate, mostly in South India. This map shows the various reservoirs in our country. So reservoir, you can go through these reservoirs because they may ask in the prelims questions. The researchers from IIT Gandhinagar, they conducted the assessment in these seven reservoirs. They found out that the mean rainfall in these catchments will increase by about 6 to 11%, and the air temperature annually is predicted to rise about 2.5 degrees Celsius by the end of this century. And this 2.5 degrees Celsius is only if the emissions are low. If the emissions are high, the temperatures will be increased even further. And this increase in water level is not just a negative thing to the hydropower generation, but it can even lead to grave situation like flood and other disasters like what we are seeing in Kerala today. The fourth article we are going to see today is with respect to Employers Provident Fund Organization. The Employers Provident Fund Organization, that is EPFO, has released a new set of data. The EPFO data are not the right gauge of employment level. This is a statement given by few economists. The data given by employers and the Provident Fund Organization is seen as the indicator of amount of people employed in the formal sector in our country. This payroll number indicating the number of people working in formal sector data released by employers and Provident Fund Organization has seen a downward revision. So, but according to economists, this is not a serious trend and it may not imply the decrease in formal sector employment. This is because the economists say that there are some limitations in the way that the Employer Provident Fund Organization calculates its data. According to economists, there is lack of clarity about methodology being followed by the EPFO organization. That is, there is no clear way to measure the number of people employed in formal and informal sector as given by EPFO according to some economists. And the EPFO data is also silent on some other things like what happens when a person changes jobs. And this changing job is very frequent, especially in informal sector, and the EPFO data is very silent on this. The employer's provident fund data is also silent on some situations like what if a person applies for another policy when he already has an existing policy? Will the two policies under EPFO will be merged or one will be deleted? So if in case there are two policies, then that will lead to a same person accounted for two different persons. So the economists say that these situations need to be corrected in order to provide correct data. And with the implementation of goods and service tax a year ago, certain incentives were given to especially small enterprises in order to make them register under the new GST regime. So this means that the already existing small enterprises, they registered under GST, and this does not mean that new enterprises were created due to GST. So there is no new jobs created. However, the new jobs were only registered under EPFO. This miscalculation must also be corrected according to the economist. The economists also say that the EPFO totally has around 150 million members. However, out of that 150 million, the active members are only 60 million. And the data also did not make any clarifications about the additions were made whether to this 150 million or 60 million. And analyzing these dysfunctions and correcting them is very much essential to provide a bigger picture and a clear picture of formal sector existing in our country. The fifth issue we are going to see today is with respect to India and China links. India and China to improve military links. So the Indian and Chinese defense ministers, they met on Thursday and they went towards full implementation of the confidence building measures in the borders of both the countries. In order to maintain peace and tranquility across the border of China and India, which has been experiencing quite a turmoil for past 1 year, the ministers, they put forward greater sessions of interaction. So these interactions will be both at working level, including the sectors of operationalization of hotline between the relevant department of armed forces of both the countries. That is, there will be new channels wherein the armed forces of India and armed forces of China, they will be interacting with each other, which will lead towards peace. Both the armies, they are even expected to resume their joint bilateral training exercise, which is called as hand in hand. This hand in hand did not happen last year because of the Doklam standoff between India and China. The two countries, they are also working on setting up additional border meeting points along the line of actual control. So this is the line of actual control that is existing between China and India. That is disputed between Arunachal Pradesh and China is called as McMahon line. It is a disputed area. It is largely claimed by China, but it actually belongs to our country. So this area is called as Akshay Chin, which is area ceded by Pakistan to China. It is also part of Kashmir. And this area is also claimed by China, that is the Akshay Chin. And this area, the whole area is disputed between India and China again. So this whole border is called as line of control. Currently there are 5 BPM points, that is border meeting points. They are Bamla and Kibitu in Arunachal Pradesh, Dalat Beg and Chushul in Ladakh, Nathula in Sikkim. There is other announcement made on the Independence Day that another BPM point will be added. And India-China relations are very much important to maintain the stability of whole Asian region as well as the stability in this old multipolar world. So this confidence building measures is definitely a step in a positive direction. The last issue we are going to see today is security budgets of Indian companies have tripled. So Indian companies are investing more in securing their data rather than investing in new technologies as per the new survey. This is because of increasing threats from the security hackers hacking the networks of not just individuals but also companies. So in case of hacking into the computers of these huge economic companies in our country, it may lead to huge losses to the companies. In order to prevent such cyber security threats, the companies are more investing in the security rather than in technology. So the survey adds that this security investments or the budgets in especially in India have even tripled with respect to some companies. And some companies, they have even went to the extent of creating a separate department for this cyber security and employing a risk officers in order to take care of the whole cyber security issue. The survey also adds that overall at a global level, the spending for the cyber security alone, it increased for about 12.4% when compared to last year. This shows the increase in the cyber security threat all over the world. This is because of the increasing privacy concerns, persisting skill shortages, and also regulatory changes such as the new change brought by European Union's global data protection regulations. So in order to cope up with such dynamic worlds and threat from different areas, the companies are employing and investing in cybersecurity rather than investing in technology or skills. Thank you.